Well, thank you all. I hope you can hear me. It's hard to see me, I'm sure, but that's fine. It's interesting that this presentation is on FootGolf, and FootGolf is probably the newest sport in this nation. And I thought I'd just give you a quick introduction, a quick run through, to show you something that is another source of revenue. And so without too much further ado, we'll see if we can get this rolling, because I'm going to start it with just a 1 minute video that sort of tells the whole story. So we'll see if we can get that. There we go. Everything I needed to know, or that presentation. The golf started over in Europe, and it caught on. It was started by a bunch of retired professional soccer players who were interested in golf, and they said, let's put this together. And so they started over there. It's caught on. It's gotten pretty hot over there, and it's moved around, picked up, and then moved to from Europe to South America. Was pretty active there, and they had the first World Cup in 2012. In Budapest, so it definitely took off over there. In 2011, the Ballestrini family brought FootGolf to America, and they actually started down in Miami, and they got the game going. They came out to California and gave me a call and said, have you ever heard of FootGolf? And I said, no, but is this golf and soccer? And they said, yes. And they said, just Google it up, and if you're interested, call us back. That was just over a year ago, and obviously we called them back, and we were the first course in California. Up in Sacramento, Mike Woods at Hagen Oak put in the second course, and Mike taught us quite a bit on how you do this. What is it? It's basically golf, but instead of using golf clubs, you use a soccer ball, and you kick the ball, but everything else is the same. It's you have par threes, you have par fours, par fives. The big difference is it's a short course, and the reason it's a short course is because most of us cannot kick a soccer ball much further than 50 yards. And so, as you saw from the slides, those were some professional soccer players. They move it a little bit better. But this makes it fit with the par 72 type concept, and so it's just like that, the same rules, the same customs. It's very easy to adapt to a golf course. Some of the factors, though, that do come into play that are different from golf. One is the undulations. Soccer balls, like the one we've got up on the stage, the number five soccer ball, is kind of light. And so if you have a downhill and you kick that soccer ball, it's not going to stop till it gets to the bottom of the hill. You know, the golf ball is a little denser and it doesn't roll quite as far. So undulations, wind, and hazards. When you play FootGolf, you generally only bring one soccer ball. So when you build your FootGolf course, you want to keep it away from those big lakes and, you know, those kind of hazards when you're designing the FootGolf course to avoid that. What we do, though, is we build it in the fairways and roughs, and we do not use the actual golf greens. And so there's almost zero wear and tear on the golf course. And as you saw from the video, this is a FootGolf cup. And when you're not playing FootGolf or it's not in play, the lid is on it. But when it's time to play FootGolf, then mowers can go over the lid and you know, golf carts can drive over the lid. Doesn't hurt it. But when it's time to play, you take the lid off, and what you have is this 21-inch diameter cup with a golf cup right in the middle and a flag coming out of the golf cup. And so that's what they play to. You'll be amazed at how easy it is to rip out a foot golf putt, and it's just about as frustrating as golf is from that aspect. But the hole with a 21-inch diameter and a number 5 soccer ball is about the same proportion as a golf ball to a golf cup. So it's very similar to golf, but we don't use the fairway or the greens, okay? This next one is the difference between what Mike did up at Hagen Oaks and what we did. When we first designed this, we were a little, a little cautious. We're saying, is this gonna work? Am I gonna get all my golfers irritated? You know, what's the impact of this? So we initially decided, okay, we will segregate foot golf from the golfers. And I have 36 holes out there. So it was easy for me to put the foot golf course in just a few golf holes. Again, it's very short. And my idea was, on weekend afternoons when I'm quiet, I'll shut down 9 holes, open it up to the foot golf, and at the same time, I still have plenty of opportunity for golf. Well, Mike took it to the next step and made it better. And what Mike did was he said, no, I'm going to integrate, and I will design my foot golf course so that the pace of play is the same for foot golfers as it is for golfers. And so under his plan, on a golf five par, you will have 3 foot golf holes. And on a 4 par, you have 2, and on a 3 par, you have 1. This way, you can send off a foursome of golfers, and your next foursome can be foot golfers, and you can intermix. This opened the doors for Mike to be able to offer foot golf 7 days a week, okay? Whereas I had restricted myself to weekday afternoons. And so Mike's plan was a better plan. We're in the process of rebuilding our course and measuring our pace of play to get that alignment, and we'll be opening that in the spring. Here's some of the demographics. There are a lot of soccer players out there. 26 million active, at least 26 million inactive, and it's growing. It's the game itself of foot golf. What we've found is it attracts the younger generation. And this is another part that's missing in our golf course, is the younger end of it. But golly, all these kids play soccer. In fact, I'm in Southern California, and everybody plays soccer. And so the idea of introducing this is a giant market for us. Most of the people who've come here have never been to a foot golfers, have never been to a golf course before. And we're finding that they're returning. A large percentage Hispanic, and ESPN Deporte, has started getting into the fray. So it's a growing thing. That's sort of the key market, the younger market, the Hispanic market, the soccer market. There's a little bit more. We've all heard about the problems or the challenges with golf, and foot golf takes away all those challenges. Golf takes too long to play. Well, it takes just over 2 hours to play an 18-hole round of foot golf walking. And a lot of the kids want to run, and we say, just maintain your pace with the group in front of you, you're fine. So it doesn't take too long. It's inexpensive. $10 to $20 to play are fees that anybody can afford. But what our whole idea was yeah, we'll start low as a draw to get people out and see how it goes. And finally, so we took away the cost barrier and the time barrier, and the last one is the game is too hard to play. Well, foot golf is not. Even an old guy like myself has gone out there and played it, and it's kind of fun, and I can do it. Anybody can do this. So it's great for that. The other parts, we get the cart rental, especially when we have tournaments. We see more with tournament play that we'll have golf carts. And of course, then there's all the auxiliary, like the food and beverage. Here's some of the potential users. Fundraisers, we've seen a little bit of all of those, but what we were adding to it this time, and where Mike one up me, now I have to get back even with Mike, and so what we're doing with our new course is we're going to build this and set it up, and as I said, the juniors tend to play more, but for the family approach, what we're going to do is invite people to come out with their family. The kids bring a soccer ball and play foot golf. The mom and dad bring a wedge and play the foot golf course too, to a 21-inch cup, and just work on their short game. And so this is our concept. And then we took that one step further, and we're using our foot golf course for beginners. We have a lot of beginners leagues, and especially our juniors, who who are just getting introduced to the game. And as you all know, the transition from that practice tee to the golf course is kind of onerous, you know, finding the right time. This is the perfect bunny slope, so to speak, you know, to get the kids from the practice tee to the real course. Some more statistics. It doesn't cost a whole lot to do this. We have invested at the top site $7,500, and that's including the little marketing that I've done. Okay, so your only capital outlays are the purchase of the cups, the purchase of additional flags, and really that's about it. You can build it right on your course without too much more than that. A little bit of work from the superintendents, but it's not a huge capital outlay to get this started and give it a try. Hagen Oaks added 4,000 runs. I wish I said I'd done that well, but to their tee sheet, which, and most of it's in the afternoons, this is what we also found. Of course, we only open for the afternoons, but that's what we tend to see, is it's later in the day, not your prime time golf time. And they're looking at 40 tournaments for next year, but the impressive point is that number right in the middle, $100,000 returned in an 8-month period on an $8,000 or $7,000 investment. And Mike didn't even have to do any, but he's in Sacramento. He really didn't have to do any heavy marketing for it. It was a little bit of a media frenzy. But, and as I've already mentioned, it's also an excellent addition to the junior program. Here's some of the challenges. If you're going to give this a try, the first one is that you're going to find your golfers doing this, not on my course. You know, I don't want this. You know, this is confusing. And it does. It takes some work, some effort by our pace of play staff, by our starters and greeters, to make sure that the foot golfers are coached in golf etiquette. They're not rude, they just don't know it, and so we have to coach them. At the same time, we coach our golfers to say, you know, we're briefing the foot golfers on how it works. Go out and play just like you're another foursome of golfers out there in front of you. And if pace of play is slowing down, we'll come up and intervene with that and that sort of thing. But you're going to get some resistance. You'll also get some resistance from your employees. And again, it's because it's a new concept. But once they do get into it, and the way we got our folks into it was we had a company tournament. And everybody went out and played the game. And once we did that, they sort of embraced it and jumped on. The etiquette part's a little bit harder, but we're getting there. And I'm sure we'll make some more mistakes, but we're getting there. Here's the last one is marketing. You know, we've got this mindset, and I think that's what this whole conference is about, is how do we get out of these mindsets and do something out of the box, do something different. I've got a pretty good concept of how to market to golfers. Soccer players, I don't know a thing about. And so if you try this, one of the first people you want to go find is your local city parks and recreation person, because they have someone who has the list of all the soccer teams and all the soccer players. The AYSO folks, and they will get you help. They'll help get you started in the right direction to go out and introduce the game to these kind of organizations. But the challenges really are minimal, especially when you look at those numbers. So that's it. Are you open to it? As the bullet says, it's not necessarily open to everyone. We're looking at the course we're playing tomorrow. This is a resort course, and it's beautiful. And this is Florida's prime time. They're not going to put foot golfers out here right now, but you can make this course, build this course, and the golfers will never even know it's there when it's not in play, okay? And then when it starts getting warm in Florida, or those afternoons and things, the play starts dropping off, it's another opportunity to generate more revenue. It does take some work to get the education, you know, not only your staff, but your customers and the foot golfers to make sure it all stays together. But it is an untapped source of potential, and especially when you look at how many soccer players there are out there. And so I've got a slide on here, and I think we will have access to these slides, but, and I should have done this earlier. I mentioned that the people who brought this game to the United States were the Balestrinis. This is Roberto.